Romans 8, and there are seven particular powerful things that Paul talks about in Romans 8. He talks about verses 1 through 8. We went over our powerful position in the Spirit. Then we talked about our powerful life in the Spirit. Then we talked about our powerful adoption by the Spirit. And last week, we talked about our powerful hope that's revealed by the Holy Spirit. And so you and see how far we can get today. Now, verses 26 through 27 talk about our powerful in the spirit, our powerful help. Sorry, in prayer, Spirit. Now, let me read that. This is chapter 8 of Romans, verse 26 and 27. It says, in the same way, the Spirit also helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Now, we need to back up just a little bit in verse 24. For in hope we have been saved, but hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he already sees? But if we hope for what we do not see with perseverance, we wait eagerly for it. In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings. And he who searches the hearts knows the mind of what the mind of the Spirit is, because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. There's a lot in that package. Now, first of all, it begins to say in the same way. When he says in the same way, what he's talking about is here in verse 24 and 25, it talks about our hope, and our hope being a certainty, even though we don't see God, we don't see Christ. Remember that faith is the evidence or the assurance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. In the same way, the Spirit intercedes for us and helps us. We do not see that. And in a day and age, so many people are looking for miracles and supernatural things. The Bible is telling us, quite, don't worry about what you see or what you experience as much as what the Word of God says. Your experiences can betray you. Your feelings can betray you. We have to be reliant and placing our faith in the written and Word of God, in what God's Word says, whether we feel like it or not. We cannot wait for our feelings to validate what God's Word says. God's Word says it, so it's true, no matter what your experience may say, no matter what your feelings may say. There is a eternal consistency, and there is a supreme foundational stability in the Word of God. So it's really important that we understand that. And what Paul is saying here is he's saying in the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for. This is very, reassuring, I think, to us as believers. Because a lot of times we go to prayer And we're not sure, I mean, just this morning, Roxanne and I always pray before I leave for work. And just this morning, we were praying about some stuff, and I wasn't sure how to word it. I wasn't sure how to say it. But I am assured that the Holy Spirit does know. The other interesting thing that it says here, when it talks about prayer, it says he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. So the Spirit is asking and acting in accordance with the will of God. So that shouldn't be a surprise to us, but I think that also there, when you talk about the Holy Spirit in the Greek being the paraclete, the helper, then we are now getting a pretty good idea of how the Holy Spirit helps us. And we're talking about prayer. The Holy Spirit is doing everything to intercede for us and ask for things according to the will of God. Because a lot of times we probably don't know how to ask, or we're probably not asking for the right thing. But it's good to know that the Holy Spirit intercedes for us. In other words, you may be praying for something that is not the will of God. You may be praying for something, maybe it's not with the right heart motive. And the Holy Spirit is not only to convict, but the Holy Spirit is there to intercede to make sure that your prayers are being funneled in accordance to God's will. It's a pretty powerful thing. When you think about how he helps us in this way. So he prays on our behalf, which is very important to understand. And his prayers for us go beyond our own comprehension. That's the real comforting thing here, I think, for believers, is that the Holy Spirit is basically, remember when it says that the Holy Spirit bears witness with our spirit, that we are our spirit, but with our spirit. And so here we can see that withness, if I can say that, being there, that we are praying and the Holy Spirit is there, adjusting and correcting our prayer and even adding things that we're not praying for in order to bring us into closer communion with God and for God's will to be done in our life. That's a very, very powerful reality. And here's one thing I got to say is that it's an extreme amount of confidence when we go to prayer. And not only that, but it should give us, we should be wanting to go to prayer a lot, knowing this truth, knowing the fact that the Holy Spirit is there with us, interceding for us, and bringing our prayers before God. And you see here the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit working within the life of the believer to bring them to sanctification. That's a very, very encouraging thing. The powerful help in our prayer by the Holy Spirit. Does anyone have any questions about that before I move to the next section?
Yes. So those 8:26 and 27 imply that there are two spirits. There's our own spirit and also the Holy Spirit reside in us in the same at the same time?
No. Okay. Is he who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is. That's God. God searches the heart. In other words, God communicates with the mind of the Spirit. And then it says, because he, this is God, this is Christ, intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. So you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all active in our prayer life. The Holy Spirit is in us and with us. The Holy Spirit communicates for us to Christ. And Christ, who knows the mind of the Spirit, intercedes for us to the Father.
Tony?
Yes.
Is everybody's screen black or is it just mine?
Everyone's screen is black.
Okay. I thought maybe I did something wrong.
No, it's because we turned the video off in order to conserve bandwidth because for some reason we're having my internet, which has never acted up before, is having an issue tonight. And so I'm not sure if it's because we're on Zoom other than Jeff, or I don't know. I have no idea why.
Okay. Hey, Tony, can I ask you, since everybody's camera's off, I'm wondering if we ought to just go ahead and let you turn your camera on so we can see you.
Well, let me try.
Okay.
Let me try and see what happens.
Because we could see you before. We could see all of us before.
Can you all see me now?
No.
Uh-oh. I look frozen there.
I don't see you at all.
Anybody. Okay.
That's okay. Let's carry on.
Yeah. I can see me, but I'm completely frozen. Wow. That's really weird. That's never happened before.
There we go.
There
you are.
Can you see me? All right.
Then your audio starts breaking up.
Okay. Let me turn it off again.
There you are again.
Okay. So, yeah.
Tony?
Evidently, something's going on with our bandwidth here. Yeah.
When it says the Holy Spirit prays on our behalf, can you give us, kind of an example of how we would be praying and how the Holy Spirit would be praying, not exactly what we're praying, but something that would be according to God's will. So like, give us a little bit of an example of that.
Sure. Maybe you're saying, I really want to buy this car, or I really want to make, or I really want to, you know, buy this house. And I'll give you a few examples. And so you're praying that the Lord will give you the ability to buy his house or buy a car, a new car or whatever. And the Holy Spirit, in knowing the mind of God, is saying, well, Lord, he doesn't need this. He's going to get himself in debt. And so his prayer really is that he would be content. So the Spirit is kind of like comes alongside of us and is when there's things that we can't express, maybe deep sorrow or deep pain, the Holy Spirit can express that for us. Or when we're praying in a way that is not in accordance to the will of God, he just corrects that.
Okay, that's a great example. What about if, okay, I've forgotten that. Let me ask you this one. Does the Holy Spirit pray on our behalf even when we're not praying?
Well, it says, in the very same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness, for we do not know how to pray, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. So I would say that Christ is our mediator and interceder, but the Holy Spirit is also. So I do think that the Holy Spirit is in constant active communication with the Father and the Son because of the fact of the Trinity. So I think whether we are, that's what, why, you know, the Bible says, don't grieve the Holy Spirit by what you do, what you say, because you can actually grieve the Holy Spirit. So It shows the personhood of the Holy Spirit. And because the Holy Spirit's not some energy that we tap. And I made this point to our men's group this Saturday. I was really surprised at their response. It was really a new thought for them. They had been thinking of the Holy Spirit as an energy they tap into and not as a person in whom we have a relationship with, just as Christ is a person in whom we have a relationship with. So, and just like the Father. So this issue that the Holy Spirit is not some energy force we tap into, but a person, means that, and he's also God, which means he's omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient. And so he's always there. He's all with the Father and the Son because he is God. So he doesn't break away from the Father and Son, and then we go to pray and he goes, oh yeah, let me get God's attention. No, he's God. So he's always in communication with the Father and the Son. That communication, that unity, that relationship is never broken. That's, by the way, which makes the indwelling Holy Spirit in the life of a believer so powerful. And I don't think we understand that.
Is the Holy Spirit the same as, like, when you speak in tongues, the Holy Spirit comes out in tongues as well?
Well, you're asking the wrong guy on that one, because I think, to me, the Bible is clear that the word tongues means, and it's unfortunate in the King James, it says tongues, but the word in the Greek is language, meaning a foreign language. And so when they retranslated the Bible, they kept, see, because in King, when you said, when someone came and spoke a foreign language, you would say he spoke a foreign tongue. So for some reason, all the translations kept that word tongue. And I think what it's caused a confusion. They should just use the word language or the word from foreign language, because that's what it means.
The Greek word Paul is logos, right?
That's the logos is the word for word.
The word, okay.
Yeah. It's not lingua, I forget. I'll look it up. But anyway, it's caused a lot of confusion. And, you know, you say, well, I speak in angelic tongues. No, you don't, because Corinthians, when it says, though I speak of tongues of men and of angels, that's a hyperbole. He's making a purposeful, impossible exaggeration to make a point. Just like he says, if I have all knowledge and know everything but have not love, does anyone have all knowledge or know everything but God? No. And then he says, though I give my body to be burned. Again, these are hyperboles. It's hyperbolic language to make a point. So because people do not understand how to read scripture and how to read language and how to keep things in context, they come up with these angelic languages that the Bible never teaches. And when the Bible talks about tongues, it's a foreign language. People want to communicate the gospel to people who, in fact, if you go back to Acts, it shows that he says, every man heard them in his own language. That's tongues. So I would say I don't believe that there is the gift of tongues active anymore, but I do believe God can certainly grant anyone at any time an ability to communicate in a foreign language should he choose so. That's up to him. Can't tell God he can't do something. But are people walking around with an ability to speak any foreign language at the drop of a hat supernaturally? I don't see it. I see a lot of babbling and that kind of thing. And, it's most of it's unscriptural because the Bible says that no more than two people are supposed to speak in tongues in a church service. And if they do, they have to have an interpreter there. And if there's not an interpreter there, it's not from God. And if more than two people speak in tongues, it's not from God. So I'm just really, I think it's really important that we hold to what God's word says about such things. A lot of the Polycarp, who was discipled by the Apostle John, he said that the gift of miracles and tongues and a lot of those miraculous gifts left when the apostles died. That was something that was given for the apostolic age in order to unify the church and display the power of the gospel. So, and that's a whole kind of different subject, but I will say that there are times when the Holy Spirit does miraculous things or gives a person a miraculous ability. That's up to God. He can do anything he wants. When those things happen, that is being done by the Holy Spirit. Hope that answers your question. It was a little bit long-winded.
Tony, I found the Greek. It's glossa. G-L-O.
Glossa,
yeah.
Glossa. Yeah.
The definition is the language or dialect used by a particular people distinct from that of other nations. So, yeah, it's kind of like a foreign language.
A foreign language. Mm-hmm. See, if you look at what the Bible says, I speak in glossa. What? I speak in a foreign language. Not some hugga or Shunda like Cocoa Puffs or, Badahana Shoulda Bada Yamaha. It's a foreign language. It's really been abused. It really has.
Yeah, it's kind of like suddenly you speak Mandarin to me, which you never learned Mandarin. That is, it's kind of like
doing
that.
Something. Yeah, that'd be great. I would love to speak Mandarin. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine you have the ability to communicate with a billion more people? It's pretty cool. That's how I see it. So anyway, is that, who asked that question originally? Is that Allison or? I didn't see
it. That was Sharon and she's giving the thumbs up right now.
Oh, okay. All right. Good deal.
Tony, Sharon is brand new, by the way. I don't know if you
what's,
do.
Oh, okay.
Sharon's brand new.
Oh, okay. Hi, Sharon. So does anyone else have any other questions? I imagine there can be a lot of questions about this because we really don't talk about prayer a lot. We talk about praying, but we don't talk about the dynamic of it. And I think that is important to know. Any other questions?
I have one more question. I mean, obviously, I know that the Holy Spirit was sent for a lot of different reasons, but I'm wondering about prayer and why does the Holy Spirit need to pray for us since we could go straight to Jesus? He hears it instantly anyway.
Well, it explains that in verse 26. It says, in the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness. So we have a weakness in that we really don't know how to pray a lot of times or what to pray. For we do not know how to pray as we should. So Paul's just saying, look, you don't know how to talk to God. This is God. And it's not a slight on us. We are his children. We're much beloved. We don't know how to talk to God. And so the Holy Spirit helps us. Now, as you mature in your Christianity, probably you learn better how to, it's like I'm at people's houses and they have a little kid, and the little kid kind of goes, "How do you back to Nashville?" And I'm like, "Holy cow." And his mom knew exactly what he said. I have no idea what the boy is saying, right? Because he's just learning how to talk. So it's kind of like that. Or if I was God and the little boy's the Holy Spirit, and this has happened, you know, a little kid will come up to me and drops it. Yeah, and I'm like, I'm sorry, I don't speak your language. And the mother come, "Oh, he wants this or this or that." So she understood him. That's what the Holy Spirit does for us. Not that God doesn't understand us, but that we don't know how to say things correctly. And it's not just about the verbiage. It's about our own heart. A lot of times our flesh gets involved with our prayers. And so the Holy Spirit is able to take our prayers and to convert them into something that is according to the will of God. And by the way, that shouldn't bother us because we want to pray according to the will of God. But a lot of times we don't. And it may be because we might have a wrong motive, or it may just be because we simply don't know how to verbalize what it is that we want to say. But the Holy Spirit will be able to those motives and pray according to the will of God. And the Holy Spirit will also be able to speak to Christ on our behalf in the way that we can't a lot of times muster up the words, especially when you're in pain or deep sadness. The Holy Spirit is there. He's the comforter, right? He's the helper. Right. So he's there to help communicate to Christ. And this whole idea of the Trinity really comes into play here because the communication is instantaneous. I mean, that's why it says he knows the mind of the Spirit. So another, when Paul is saying that he knows the mind of the Spirit, he's saying the Spirit is interceding for us, but in exact time, without any delay, in complete unity. The Father and the Son know exactly what the Spirit's thinking because they have one essence. There is complete unity there. It's a very amazing, powerful thing to realize. Ding, ding.
So do the Father and Jesus hear our words as well, or just what the Holy Spirit has interpreted?
God is omnipresent. So yeah, he hearing we think and say. But here we're talking about, for instance, God knows what every unbeliever is thinking and saying or doing at every moment, at every time. Also, he knows with us as well. And I believe what's going on as the Holy Spirit is interceding for us to Christ, to the Father, and he is communicating for us. I believe that there is also a sanctifying power behind that, in which we are, the more we speak to the Father, the more the Holy Spirit is communicating on our behalf, which means basically the Spirit is bearing witness with our spirit that we are his children. And the more that happens, listen, the more people pray, the more sanctified they become, the more their life has a spiritual power to it. And that is because they're in communion with the Spirit, the Son, and the Father, not trying to just live life on their own. So there is going to be definite good consequences for being in prayer a lot. And there's also going to be bad consequences for being in prayer a little bit. The attitude of, if you're not praying a lot, then that kind of betrays your heart attitude. It says that you feel very comfortable doing your own thing, your own way, without bringing it to the throne of Christ. And so that's something that we need to look at. And, you know, if I'm just throwing up a prayer at dinner time or something, or do I spend real time in prayer once, twice, three times, whatever a day? So if we want in our discernment, and if we want to grow in our spiritual aptitude and our sanctification, prayer is a huge, huge, huge part of that. So
thank you.
Any other questions or clarifications?
When we go to sleep, the spirits pray for us too.
What's that?
So when we go to sleep, the spirit prays for us too.
Well, I have to believe that the Holy Spirit, like I said before, is in constant communion and conversation with the Father and the Son. Mm-hmm. And because we are, let me put it this way. Robert, do you have kids?
No.
Okay. No. Okay, maybe Lee could speak to this, because he's has, I think, 5 kids. So, Lee, when your kid, are you there, Lee?
Yes.
Okay, so when your kids went to sleep at night, did you ever have conversations about them with your husband?
Yeah.
Of course. We are God's children. So, obviously, the Holy Spirit and the Son and the Father are going to be communicating to each other about us. We are the children of God. That's what parents do. So, yeah, I do believe that even when we're asleep, you know, God is communicating with the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are in constant communication, 24/7. Because they're omniscient, they see all, they know all, and they can do all. So, any other questions?
That's a great explanation. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions regarding this issue of prayer? As we're coming. I know we started late, but we're coming to the 8:30.
I got a question.
Sure. Okay.
The question is, when you pray really hard and when God answers, is it, you know, like you can see, okay, so I'm kind of like confused. One time I was praying for somebody really hard. Okay, I was praying for somebody because he lost his job. And so I was praying really, 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 really hard. And he got a job, but you know what? His boss kind of fell off the bicycle and cracked his skull, and was in the hospital so that my friend could actually have the job. And I was kind of like wondering, how come when you pray, the Father answers your prayers, but something bad happens to somebody else? It was kind of scary.
Well, I would say that I believe God is sovereign, and you weren't praying for the guy to crack his skull. You were praying for your friend to get a job. So God did not give him a job because you prayed. God gave him a job because that was his sovereign will to do that. See, we think we can influence God by praying, but that's not what prayer is for. Prayer is not about influencing God. Prayer is about allowing the Holy Spirit to influence your heart to pray according to God's will. And that is a big misunderstanding about prayer, that I want this or that, and so I'm going to pray and make God change his mind or make God do something. But what God is saying is, no, my will is sovereign, and so I am going to move you by the Holy Spirit to pray hard for your friend to get a job. And I'm going to sanctify you and teach you through this how to pray according to my will and how to pray hard.
Thank you. That was a good reminder.
Yeah, we have to remind ourselves of that, and remember what it says. It says in 27, he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. So when you're moved to pray hard about something, that is because God's Spirit is moving you to do that. Certainly not your flesh, right? So God's Spirit is moving you because God allows us to be part of his great plan to reach people. And when we pray for the salvation of people, when we pray for people to get jobs, that's not to say that God is going to answer that in the positive all the time. But God is teaching us and moving us to do that. Paul prayed 3 times that his affliction in his eyes would go away. And God said, you know what? Stop praying about it. It ain't going to happen. Why didn't God tell him that the first time he prayed? Well, God was teaching him something. But he finally made it clear, nope, it's not going to happen. I want this in your life to keep you from being prideful. So our prayer is being directed and motivated by the Holy Spirit, by the flesh. Sooner or later, we'll figure that out. And the Holy Spirit will still pray according to the will of God, even though our flesh may be motivating us. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. Makes great sense.
Okay. Yeah, I think really understanding the person of the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit does in our life is very helpful and key to having more confidence in living for Christ and in prayer, in our position. All this is, you know, comes through understanding who the Holy Spirit is. Okay, it's 8:31, and we have 2 more sections to go through, which I think I'm going to save for next week.
I was going to suggest if you want to go an extra 10 minutes, it's okay, because we did get a
little. Well, an extra 10 minutes ain't going to do it. I'll just get a little bit into verse 28, because verse 28 is really powerful.
Okay.
And so I want to be able to have time to go through that, because I think it's going to spark a lot of question and discussion. And so I definitely want to have the time to do that.
Yeah, you're probably going to get a lot of questions, because it says, for those who love God. Who are those?
Those who love God and are called according to
called. Him. Yeah.
Oh, there's that election thing coming up again.
Mm-hmm.
It's everywhere.
We're going to unpack that next week.
Yeah, there's a lot to unpack there, and I want to be able to do that, not run through it. It's never worth rushing through. So there you go. Okay, well, we can open it up for question time.
And for those of you who are new, which would be, hi, Sharon, the questions are less formal, so you can ask anything you want.
Feel free. Nothing political.
Yeah, no politics.
No politics.
We got another one. No politics. You see, everybody got quiet because of.
I have a question. Political. Hello.
Sure.
Hello.
Yeah.
Is that me?
Go, Mom.
Yeah. There is a verse somewhere, and I can't find it, but I found it a couple of days ago, that says, see to it that you do not blot your name out of the book of life. What does that mean?
What verse is that?
Oh, I don't know. I can't remember where it is, but I looked it up and I found it. And it says, see to it that your name is not blotted out of the book of life. So it sounds like your name could be in there, but it could be blotted out. Maybe you blotted out yourself. I don't know. You're not familiar with the verse, are you? I'll ask my question.
Revelation 17:8.
I can confirm that. I just found it too. Revelation 17:8.
Mm-hmm.
So it has to be in there.
Warm reading there. Right.
In order to be blotted out.
All dwell worship him and be sacred. Not written.
Well, this verse. This name says it has not been written in the book of life. But this other verse that I found implied that it was blotted out of the book.
I'm looking at something right now.
Has to do with the woman and the beast. Revelation 17.
Thir- 13:8 says our names were written in the book of life before the foundation of the world.
Mm-hmm. That too, yeah.
Oh, interesting. Okay. There's this may be a translation issue. First of all, it says, we know that it says from the foundation of the world that our names were put in the book of the life. It also said, Jesus says, I will not lose one of them. But what's interesting is that that. He who overcomes will thus be clothed in white garments, and I will not erase him from the book of life, and I will confess him before my Father and his angels. So that verse, that's 3:5, it carries the suggestion of a believer being erased from the book of life. But that suggestion isn't, I don't think it's intentional.
And what verse is that?
That's Revelation 3:5 says, Jesus explicitly says he will not erase a believer's name. And Jesus never says he will erase a believer's name. Jesus, it's really interesting because it's a double negative.
Yeah. Well, the verse that I read had the word blot in it.
Yeah.
And I don't know where I found it. I should have looked it up before. But it said, see to it that you don't blot your name out of the book of life. You yourself. I mean, that was the impression I got. Now, I'm sure I could be misunderstanding it, but that's what it was saying to me. See to it that you personally don't blot your name out of the book of life, which to me implied that your name was there.
Yeah, that was Revelation, was it 17:8?
No, it wasn't. That
wasn't the one. 17:8. Let's see.
Because Revelation 3:5 says, I will never blot his name out of the book of life.
Yeah, and some say, there's a possibility that someone can get their name blotted out. But Jesus uses in the Greek a double negative, which implies the impossibility of a believer being blotted out, not the possibility. And so that's what I was saying, is a translational issue there.
Yeah.
What did verse say? Be careful.
My understanding of the verse was, be careful that you yourself do not blot your name out of the book of life. Which to me said that God writes everybody's name in the book of life, but obviously it doesn't mean that. But it was, you know, I should have the verse before I ask the question. I looked at
is that a real verse or somebody's writing?
I'm sorry,
is that a real verse? Or is this somebody's interpretation?
I looked it up. And
you know what I'm saying, when people say that you can be blotted out of the book of life, they're using Revelation 17:8. Let's see what it says. Depending on the translation, you refer to those whose names were not written in the book of life, the creation of the world. 17:8. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit to go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world when they behold the beast that was not. So that verse is just saying that unbelievers are not written in the book of life. And the only thing that mentions about being blotted out is Revelation 3:5. When he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before the Father and before all the angels. And that Jesus uses a double negative there, which implies it's impossible for any believer to be, but Jesus is just saying that. I will not blot you out. It can't happen. So every true believer, there's no possibility for their name to be blotted in the book of life. But it does say that there are people whose name was never in the book of life. That's why Ephesians say that from the foundation of the world, he chose us from the foundation of the world. And from the foundation of the world, before even creation was made, God wrote our names in the book of life. Again, this speaks to the election issue and the sovereignty of God. But now here in Psalm 69:28, it says, let them be blotted out of the book of the living, not the book of salvation or of life, but the book of the living, and not be written with the righteous. So what David, that's an imprecatory psalm, and it's very important to understand that imprecatory psalms are not examples of how we should pray. David was God's representative on earth. He was the king. He had a certain authority so that he could pray a certain way. It's called an imprecatory psalm. And also, he's not talking about the book that is where people were written by the foundation. He's actually talking about that God would take them out because they're so wicked.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's nothing there's nothing really that I can see that says that.
Well, I probably misread it or didn't get the right interpretation, but it was my impression that he was saying that I personally should see to it that I not blot my name out.
Well, Lee, you better make sure you don't get your name blotted.
Yeah, I'm gonna get my concordance out again.
Jesus was very clear,
yeah,
that every believer, he will not lose one of them.
Yes, and I believe that. Yeah.
And the only way we can lose our salvation is if somehow the work of Christ fails.
Yeah.
So the issue always is not whether or not you can lose your salvation. It's always, are you truly saved?
Yeah.
That's really the question.
Yeah. I believe that too. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions out there?
So what I read in Revelation 17:8, the second part, which says, whose name has not been written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, will wonder when they see the beast, right? So if you are truly a believer, you will not be wonder. You look at the beast, it's kind of like, that's just fake. We're not going to believe it, right? It's you're not going to be mesmerized. Right. You're not going to be transfixed by whatever wicked scheme that he professes. Yeah.
Yep. That's exactly.
We will be able to tell the difference.
So it's interesting that the double negative that is used doesn't really come out in English, but it's when double negatives used like that in the Greek, they're talking about the impossibility of something happening. So in this case, Jesus is saying for the believer, it's impossible for their name to be blotted out. Mm-hmm.
So what happened to Judah who betrayed Jesus? His name was erased?
So say that again.
Judah, who betrayed
Judas? Judas.
His name was never in it.
Never in it. So he never believed.
Nope.
Oh.
Nope. Right when Jesus picked him, he says, I've chosen you 12, but one of you is.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
So Judas, his motive was not right. He wanted a political kingdom to overthrow the Roman Empire, right?
Yeah.
So he wanted Jesus to do that.
I think it was more than that. He saw Jesus as the way to make money. And when Jesus made it clear, if you follow me, you're not going to be rich, he didn't like that. And when that woman broke that very expensive perfume and poured it over Christ, he was offended. And he was offended because he thought, why doesn't she give it to us so we can go sell it and get money? Because he wanted to put the money in his pocket. So he was following Christ because he thought he would have status and money. But when it became clear, and Jesus made it clear, follow me, you know, if they've done this to me, how much more will they do? The foxes have holes and the birds have trees, but the Son of Man has not a place to lay his head. So the disciples were okay with that. They understood that it was not about their life here and now, but it was about the kingdom. Judas never looked at the kingdom. He just looked at the here and now and what he could get for himself. When he figured out that he wasn't going to get what he wanted, he betrayed Christ.
You know, Judas was very, very sorry what he did because he went and killed himself, but he didn't repent. That doesn't make sense to me, Judas.
Well, I'll tell you why. Both Judas and Peter really messed up. But Peter, his hope was in Christ. He knew his only hope. And that becomes very obvious when Jesus says, you must drink of my blood and eat of my flesh. And it says a lot of his disciples stopped following him. And so he turned to his 12 and said, are you going to stop following me too? And Peter said, where else can we go? Only you have the words of life. So Peter knew that failure or not, the only hope he had was to continue to come back to Christ and seek forgiveness and repentance. Judas never wanted Christ to be over his life. He never wanted to surrender to Christ. So when he did what he did, there was no thought for forgiveness because he was never under the influence of Christ. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
He would rather kill himself than come to Christ for forgiveness.
So he wasn't really remorseful.
No.
He as Paul says, he had a worldly sorrow, which leads to death, but a godly sorrow leads to repentance.
Oh, okay.
And repentance means what? You come back to Jesus and say, I've blown, you know, worldly sorrow, you just go your own way.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
That was good because I never really thought of it in that direction. So thanks.
I think Judas thought he was joining a startup.
Yeah. I think he was expecting Christ, I think it was Robert that said this, to be a political leader and to usher in a great kingdom right then and now, and that he was going to be rich and he was going to be powerful. And when it came became obvious to him that that's not what was going to happen. Remember, Jesus said, I must go to Jerusalem and I must die. And that's when he just thought, well, I'm at least going to get some money out of this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that explanation on worldly sorrow. So I have a question on, you know, you're talking about the Holy Spirit interceding for us prayer-wise. And I have friends that are Catholic, and I would say Christian Catholic. They're really strong believers and biblical, but I'm confused that I don't know, you know, do I say this or just let our differences be differences? But is, you know, how they pray to the saints, and yet, you know, I say, well, I can pray directly to Jesus, God, I have the Holy Spirit, I can ask people that are alive to join me in prayer, to pray on my behalf. So is there a verse that says, you know, you shouldn't be praying to saints? I mean, this isn't my belief, but I don't want to, you know, have division.
Here's what I'm going to say. If someone's an actual real Christian, they will not stay in the Catholic Church. Because if you believe Catholic dogma, you are not a believer. Because the Catholic Church teaches a works-based salvation. They teach that when you get baptized by the Catholic Church, your original sin is washed away. But you must perform certain things in order to continue to rid yourself of sin. You must keep all the sacraments of the church. So what it does is it says Jesus didn't once and for all set you free from the penalty and power of sin, but that you, the Catholic Church, is the one who takes away your sin. You've got to do communion, you know, all the sacraments of the church. If you don't do the sacraments, then your sins aren't going to be covered anyway. You got to go to purgatory to what? Pay for your sins. This is not the gospel. It's not Christian. It's satanic. So for someone to say, I am a through and through Catholic Christian, I'm saying, sorry, that's impossible. You cannot accept the teachings of the Catholic Church, which is not salvation by faith in Christ alone. It is salvation by works. It is salvation that's maintained by the power of the Catholic Church. When my mom became a Christian, she ended up leaving the Catholic Church because took about a year or so, but she finally figured it out. That this is not the gospel. This is not Christianity. It's the worship of Mary and which is, you know, the co-matrix, that Mary was also sinless and somehow equal to God. I mean, it's very vile. When you start digging into Catholic dogma. Also, it's important to know that the Bible says there we have only one mediator between man and God. There's only one, and that is Jesus Christ. So, I mean,
I've always had a problem with that, where they think they have to go to the priest. And I've said that, but I didn't really know a couple of these other things that you mentioned, that I was wondering why one of them asked me how I was assured that I was saved. So now what you're saying, they believe they have to keep doing perfect. I didn't realize
they're
that.
Not assured of their salvation because of what Christ did. They're assured of their salvation because of what they continue to do, and that the Catholic Church holds their salvation in the church's hand, which is what made the Catholic Church so powerful during the Middle Ages. And it wasn't until Martin Luther and Wycliffe and a lot of the other people spoke out and said that the Catholic Church is false, that you have to believe in Christ alone. It is faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone, period. That's how someone is saved. And as soon as they started, Wittenberg got the press going, and they started getting Bibles out to the common people, then to lose their power. As the Catholic Church taught that their salvation was held within the Catholic Church. Look, if you have to come to the priest, do communion, be baptized, be married in the Catholic Church, if you have to do all the sacraments in order to be saved, and all of those sacraments are done in the Catholic Church, then who holds your salvation in their hand? So if they kick you out of the Catholic Church, you're going to hell, period, because you have no way to be. So it's wicked, it's evil, it's a false teaching. And I know people like to, well, Catholics are Christians too. Not if they believe Catholic doctrine, they're not. I'm sorry. That's not my rules. That's Christ's. Period.
No, thanks for, you added on a few more things because I basically, knew I didn't agree with having to go for confession because we have a direct line and I don't agree that, with a couple of other things, but I thought it was more minor, but no, this is major. So thank you. Thank you, Tony.
And it developed in the 6th century or whatever, began to develop that way because the Catholic Church saw it as a way of controlling kings and controlling countries and controlling people. And it wasn't till the Reformation where the Catholic Church's hold was kind of broken. They hold a lot of influence, but not like they did in the Middle Ages when they ruled the world, except for Islam.
So another way to refute or not argue, but another way to counter that would be for Stacy, it's just ask them questions. Says, okay, this is what you believe. Can you point to where in the Bible that says that? Ask questions. Ask them to answer what they believe in. If they cannot, you have an open door.
But I would tell you that this person loves the Lord and is.
Right. So you want to be ready too. You got to be prepared yourself. Yeah. You should study your own, study your Bible, be prepared. And then if they cannot answer it, then it's when you come in with your answer. I mean, do it with love. Do it with love.
Of course. Yeah.
I would say too, make sure you bathe it in prayer. Yeah. Have an opportunity to talk and just look. This is what the Bible says. See, here's the insidious intellect of the Catholic Church. One of the first things that they did is they said the whatever the Pope says, church councils say, is equal to the Bible.
Even though
it contradicts the Bible. But see, that's how they were able to deal with anyone who said, well, the Bible doesn't say that. They said, well, we are the Bible too.
Hey. Wrong.
And, I mean, it's really, when you talk about a way to get control of people, Islam does the same thing. Mm-hmm. The Catholic Church used to read Latin. Well, no one spoke Latin. So what they would do is they'd read the Bible in Latin to the common man, and then they would tell them what it means. And it had nothing to do with what they read. It was a way of keeping control. And by the way, Islam does the same thing. The the teachers, or what are they called? What do they call the teachers?
Priests.
Well, they're not priests. They have a specific name.
Clerics. The clerics.
The clerics. The clerics. They do the same thing that the Catholic Church did. And that is the mullahs. That's who they are. They're the mullahs. I had looked for them. The mullahs, what they do is they come in, and here's the thing. The Quran is only to be spoken and taught out of Arabic. Okay? Mm-hmm. Not a lot of people speak Arabic. Okay? And this is interesting because the Muslims will brag that all of people memorize the entire Quran. But you're only allowed to memorize the Quran in Arabic. So if I ask you to memorize the Bible in Spanish, and you don't speak Spanish, you'd be able to memorize, but you would have no idea what it says. And for most Muslims, that's exactly what it is. When they go to the madras, or when they go to wherever my words are leaving me today. Anyway, the madras is a Mecca. School, but
Mecca.
Well, Mecca, or mosque. When they go to the mosque or the madras, they're always taught out of Arabic. They have no idea what the mullah is saying. Then the mullah tells them what he says. It's the same thing the Catholics did. They'd read it in a language the people didn't understand, and then they would tell them what it means. So that's a great way to keep control of people. Keep them in the dark. Sure. And then tell them, the Quran is actually saying you need to go, blow up Americans or blow up Jews. That's what it's saying, whether it says it or not.
Isn't the Christian Bible say that thou shalt not kill, and that actually happened in the Ten Commandments, is very direct, then why is it that people are still carrying guns and also shooting?
Okay, the Bible does not say thou shalt not kill. It says thou shalt not commit murder.
Murder,
yeah. That's the Hebrew word. God also says in Romans 13 that the government does not bear the sword in vain. And also it says, if a man takes a man's life, by man must his life be taken. So there's a difference between murdering someone and killing someone. If someone comes at you with a knife and attacks your family and you have a gun, what are you going to do? Thou shalt not kill. No, you're going to shoot him. Because at this point, you're not committing murder. It's self-defense. So these are some of the...
Do some booby trap, and you don't have to kill the person. You can hit them with a baseball bat or a tranquilizer gun, and they're not dead, and you can just tie them up and give them to the police. You don't have to shoot them.
Sometimes
you may not have a tranquilizer gun on handy, and you may not have enough notice to go make a booby trap for him. Sometimes you're sleeping in your house alone and someone's breaking in and may attack you. And in this case, you may have to defend yourself and your family. You may have to kill them. And that's not murder, that's self-defense. There's a big difference there. The Bible is very clear not to kill innocent people. The Bible's also clear that if a man takes another man's life, then by man must his life be taken. In other words, life is precious. And when someone steals that life from another person, they forfeit life. Now, can we decide to take mercy on someone? Can't. But if someone is going to attack you, your duty is to protect your family and protect yourself. And, shoot them in the leg. But I guarantee you, if they have a gun and they're going to shoot you in the face, you're not going to shoot them in the leg. So a lot of this, you know, it's very important for take the Bible at what it says in proper context.
Yeah, let me add the definition of the thou shalt not murder. The word in Hebrew is ratsach. So it means premeditated or assassination, right? So you kill someone with intent.
Right.
Right.
It's
not accidental. Right.
You're killing an innocent person. You're thinking about it. You're plotting it. And so that, you know, this is the statutes that made our laws here in America were taken out of the Ten Commandments.
Mm-hmm. And Antonio,
says that thou should not kill. The King James Version said that.
Right, but the Hebrew word is the word for murder. Premeditated murder.
Yeah, we have to go to the original language.
Yeah.
We can't rely on the translation.
But when you kill, you're murdering somebody anyway.
What's that?
When you kill, you're actually murdering, actually.
No, you're not. You're not. The word that the Bible uses for murder, premeditated assassination of an innocent person. Someone breaks into your house with a gun and their intent is to kill you, they're the one that is trying to commit murder. If you shoot them and kill them, you are defending yourself. You have not committed murder. You are practicing self-defense.
But did Jesus say anything about that?
Romans 13 specifically says that the government doesn't bear the sword in vain, and that's talking about the ability of capital punishment. But Jesus never said you couldn't defend yourself. You know, here's an interesting thing. Roman soldiers came to John the Baptist and they said, what must we do? And he did not tell them, stop killing people, stop going to war. He didn't say that. He said, be content with your wages and do not use your people and get bribes and steal money from citizens. The power you have as a soldier. He hopped out of the army and stopped killing people. He never said that. And neither did Jesus. When the centurion came to Christ and said, heal, Jesus said, I'll heal her, but you know what? You need to stop going to war. He never said that. In fact, the centurion said to Jesus, I am a man who have people under my authority, and I say go, and they go. And Jesus commended that man for that example. So it's the if you want to be a pacifist, that's fine, and that's your choice. But you cannot defend or you cannot indict people for self-defense. You can't, because the Bible doesn't do that. It just doesn't. Any other question? I'm going to probably stop around 15, guys, because I am so tired.
Okay.
Yeah. So to expand on that. So it's okay for us to be in the military, to serve our country, to fight wars, and you know, because according to Romans 13:4, right, the government, they bear the sword,
Yes.
Yeah. Right.
And also that every government has been placed in power by God for his sovereign will.
Mm-hmm.
I see Christians saying that faith in itself cannot save us. But again, Christian, you have to read the context of that. What James is saying is that faith, true faith, results in a changed life. In other words, I don't do good things to be saved. I do good things because I'm saved. And what James
It's the same concept. I disagree that the Catholic Church that you're saved by faith. But if you don't have any works to back it up, then your faith is meaningless. This is what they say. They do not say you're saved by works. But it's the same concept. It's the discussion that we had when you're saying you cannot lose your salvation, but if someone does, you say, well, this person was not saved to begin with, right?
That's not what the Catholic Church says.
Well,
the Catholic Church says you have to do certain things to pay for your sin. That's what purpose is all about. You're paying for your sin, not Jesus. You are. And if you want to keep your sins being forgiven, you better go to the priest, take communion. That's Catholic doctrine. You cannot deny that. That's what they believe. That is not faith in Christ alone. That is a works-based salvation. You are doing something to maintain your salvation. What James is saying is that if you've truly been saved, you've become a child of God. And if you become a child of God, you're going to act like a child of God, not because you're trying to keep your salvation, but because it's who you are. There's a big difference there. James is used a lot by Jehovah's Witnesses to try to convince people to work for their salvation. That's not what James is saying. James is saying if you've truly become a child of God, it's going to show in how you live your life. But those works are not something that save you. Those works are an evidence of your salvation. That's exactly what James is trying to say. That's not what the Catholic Church or the Mormons or the Jehovah's Witnesses say.
I mean, the communion is more like a ritual, right? Because we are supposed to do this. Jesus
name. The communion is not just a ritual. You need to read Catholic doctrine. They believe in transubstantiation. You eat that wafer, it literally turns into the flesh of Christ. When you drink that wine, it literally turns into the blood of Christ. And the only way for you to maintain your salvation is to have the Catholic Church give you communion so you can eat the literal flesh of Christ and drink the literal blood of Christ. That is not what the Bible teaches. That's what the Catholic Church teaches because they want to maintain control over people. And your salvation is, just read what the Catholic doctrine says. If you're not a part of the Church Universal or the Catholic, you are not able to go to heaven. The only way you can go to heaven is through the sacraments of the Catholic Church. That's not me saying that. That's Catholic doctrine. Period. That's just fact.
Do the rank and file
don't think Catholic like that?
There's probably a lot of Catholics that have not thought it out. Yeah. But the fact is, as a Catholic, you have to confess your sins to the priest in order for them to be forgiven, which means the priest has power over your salvation and the Catholic Church do. You have to take communion in the Catholic Church in order for your sins to be forgiven. You have to be baptized in the Catholic Church in order for your original sin to be taken away. It doesn't matter that you're a baby and have no idea what you're doing. All of this was designed by the Catholic Church to tell people you will go to hell if you do not come to the Catholic Church. And even if you do come to the Catholic Church, you're going to have to go to purgatory. What? Pay for your own sins is works salvation. You are paying for your sins. The Catholic Church is paying for your sins. But the one person who's not paying for your sins is Jesus. That's just fact. That's just truth. That's common knowledge. That's common knowledge.
No, I don't know.
Now, don't the Catholics and Mormons believe that you can pray on someone else's behalf and, you know, someone that's deceased? Don't they believe that they can intercede, which isn't biblical because the Lord holds everybody accountable for their choice right. of receiving him right. or not?
And this is why I'm saying, Christian, you can disagree about this, and that's fine, but I've talked to one Catholic priest. I've been on YWAM with Catholic priests. I've done classes in schools where it's a religious study, and I've come in along with a Catholic priest. They don't deny any of this. You're not denying what I'm saying. You're denying what Catholic priests would tell you.
Well, I have a question.
Sure.
Do you think it's possible that a Catholic who's not a scholarly type can come to Christ and fully understand their need for Christ, his blood, well, faith in Christ for forgiveness of sins, and not actually see the difference? I mean, no, they would know the difference, but they, again, they're not very scholarly, and this is something that a traditional
perspective. I've known several people, my mother being one of them, who became a Christian reading her Bible while she was a Catholic. Every single one of those people that I know that's happened to, they've all left the Catholic Church because the Holy Spirit tells you, danger, Will Robinson, danger.
Well, that makes a lot of sense. Let me ask you this. I have a girlfriend who is, she Christian with no question about it, but she and her husband decided, since they had a Catholic background, to the Catholic Church and lead as many people there to a saving faith as much as possible. Now, how do you respond to that?
Well, now they're missionaries.
Yes.
That's what people saying, look, I don't believe that this is the body and blood of Christ. I don't believe that you should be baptizing your baby because your baby has no knowledge of what it's doing. I'm not praying saints. I mean, are they taking that stand? If so, that's fine. And they can, you know, don't go in and be deceptive and be praying to saints and doing all this other stuff like you agree with it. You're going to have to go in and say, look, I don't agree with, and that's what happened with my mom. She started telling the priest, hold on, I don't need to come to you. And I'm not praying to the saints. And what? This community, you know, and she kept having these real disagreements with her priest, who would say, no, you've got to, if you want to be saved, you got to come to your communion. And she finally said, no, that's not what the Bible says. And she left. So if you're going to do that, if you're going to be a missionary within the Catholic Church, fine, but do it honestly, you know.
Yeah.
Don't pretend to believe what they believe, because now you're being deceptive.
Dishonest. Yes.
No. So
that's not the case.
So she may be, I do know some people that have made that decision, but what ends up usually happening is they get asked to leave.
Okay. What about, like, for example, Mormons who obviously don't, I mean, they're good people, surely, but they don't have the gospel, as they don't pray to the same Jesus and the same God as we do. But do you think it's possible to be a Mormon who, again, not scholarly, but worships in the Mormon church?
I would say if they're reading their Bible, it's very possible for them to get saved, but they will not remain in the Mormon church because it's satanic. It's satanic. They teach a different God. They teach a different Jesus. They tell women that your husband has to not Jesus doesn't resurrect you from the dead, like the Bible says. Your husband resurrects you from the dead, so you better be good to your husband. Boy, that puts a lot of power in the husband's hands, doesn't it? Did a man invent this religion? I think so. God lives on a planet called Kolob. Women will remain eternally pregnant to populate that when you, a Mormon man, when he gets resurrected, he will get his own planet and be a god, and life will populate that planet by being eternally pregnant. Yeah, that's wicked, evil, yuck, yuck. Period. Period. It's way out there, man. It's way out there. God lives on a planet called Kolob. I mean, come on, man.
Okay, that's obvious. That's obvious. I just think about people who are maybe they're just not people. But you know, you answered it because of what you're saying.
Yeah.
Even if they're not scholarly, they do have the Holy Spirit that will lead them. So that was. That makes sense to me.
I'm going to tell you that when I was going to community college and certain things were being taught, and I was going, that's not right. But I couldn't tell you why. No, that's not right. And I couldn't know why, but it was the Holy Spirit in me going, no, don't listen to that.
That makes a lot of sense to me.
That's why I'm glad doing Romans 8, to realize the Holy Spirit is not some force you tap into. The Holy Spirit is a person who's with you and in you. So when things happen, the Holy Spirit throws the flag, you know, watch out. Just like I've told you this story before, I'll tell you it again. My mom suffered with cancer for a good part of her life. I was a little kid and heard that there was a pastor in San Francisco who was healing people from cancer. And so she dad into taking her, and so my dad took her. They sat down, and 5 minutes into the sermon, my dad looked at my mom and said, "This guy is satanic, and we're getting out of here." And it's really interesting. See, for my mom, she wasn't a believer yet, but my dad was. And that person that was preaching was Jim Jones of the People's Temple.
Oh, wow!
Wow!
Oh my goodness!
My dad saw right through him. 5 minutes, he goes, "This man's satanic. We're getting the heck out of here." Grabbed my mom's hand and took my mom out. Said, "This man can't do anything." So the Holy Spirit is a person. And it says, you know, when that laughing revival was happening, you know, my wife came in and said, "Tony, look at this on the TV. What do you think's going on?" I said, "That's satanic. Satanic. People barking like dogs and doing that." You know where you hear that stuff? You hear that in pagan religions. You do not see that in Scripture.
What revival are you talking about?
It was that the Toronto
blessing.
Yeah, or the laughing revival. Listen, if God's going to do a revival on this country, it's not going to be through laughter, people. It's going to be through bended knees and tears. There, people were barking like dogs and all of that. You hear that in satanic mystical religions and pagan religions. You do not see that in the Bible.
Hey, what about faith healing? I mean, Tony, what about faith healing?
God can heal anyone he wants at any time, but most to these people that I fakes. I'm sorry, they're fakes. People come, oh, my headache's gone. Oh, my back feels better. Well, replace an eyeball, raise the dead, go into a hospital and clear it out. They don't do that. And what's always good with these guys? Money. Money, 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 money. They're multi-multi-millionaires. These are false teachers. They're what the Bible calls in Jude, they are black clouds that produce no rain. When a farmer sees a black cloud, he goes, oh, good, water for my crops. But these guys, they produce no water or nourishment. They just fill their own pockets. They're false teachers.
Yeah, there's an expose from ABC on Benny Hinn. You need to watch that documentary. It's the people actually has the real ailments that they really need to be healed. They will prevent it from going down.
Yeah, they keep to them be, out. Yep.
They keep them out. They only invite those people who have no outward illness, and then they fake it. They make them fall down and then, you know, do all the crazy thing on the floor.
You know, when you see a guy that's a multimillionaire with four or five mansions, and, you know, you got to ask yourself why they're doing what they're doing. And most of these guys, you know, Jim Jones was the same way. Oral Roberts and, you know, all those guys, the Word of Faith movement. It's not biblical. All you have to do is look and see what their doctrine is, and you see it's not biblical, then you know God's not behind it. God doesn't contradict, though.
Tony, what about Joel Osteen?
Joel Osteen?
Yeah.
Okay. When Larry King asked Joel Osteen, how come you don't preach about sin and repentance and salvation like John MacArthur does? Mm-hmm. And you know what Osteen said? Well, that's not my ministry. Really? Well, then what is your ministry, pal? To tell nice stories and give people good feelings and do a little self-help for them and give them nothing? Cloud without rain. It's a false teacher.
Yeah. I saw that interview. It was bad.
Yeah, it's really bad. And he's admitting that he's a false teacher. Basically, doesn't know he's doing that, but he is.
He's just a motivational speaker, basically.
That's what he is. He's a motivator. But people go to him because they don't want conviction. They want to be told that God's going to make them rich and healthy and wealthy and give them everything their flesh wants. Well, where's the spirit in their life? Where's the spirit craving for sanctification and repentance and spiritual disciplines? Well, I think most of the people in the church do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, because if the Holy Spirit was in their life, they'd know this guy's a fake.
Do you think do you think that these people are allowed to talk like that? Because some people just need positivity preaching in their lives.
No, I'm going to tell you that these teachers have a lot of people in their church because a lot of people do not want to hear the gospel. They do not want to feel conviction. They do not want to be called to repentance. So it's just like what Paul told Timothy. Let me find it for you. Because I think right here, I could quote it, but I think I would like rather find it. Robert probably knows exactly where I'm going.
Is it the one about that get your ears tickled or something like that?
Yep. Yeah. He talks about the last days. Mm-hmm. He's says in see the power of life, therefore be strong. He says, but realize this, that in these days difficult times will come, for men will be lovers of self, lovers of money, boastful, arrogant, revilers, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, unloving, irreconcilable, malicious, gossips, without self-control, brutal, haters of good, treacherous, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to a form of godliness, although they have denied its power. So what does that say? They look religious on the outside, but they have denied the Holy Spirit any entrance into their life. Avoid such men as these, for among them are those who enter into households and captive weak women weighed down with sins, led impulses, always learning, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Just as Janus and Jambres opposed, I wanted to get to that part. Is this not? Apostles deceived, Lystra, persecuted, you however.
This is 2 Timothy 4, right?
Is it 2 Timothy
4? What chapter?
Do you have it?
What chapter are you looking at?
I thought it was 2 Timothy. Do you have it?
Oh, okay. Let me go back. The difficult times.
You know what? It might be. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. 2 Timothy 3. And then also 3 and 4 both.
Let's see. Now I followed my teaching and conduct and perseverance, but they will not further the progress. You know what? I'm thinking. Yeah, I wonder if it's in 1.
Yeah, 2 Timothy 4:3, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled, and they will accumulate for themselves teachers according to their own desires.
Is that 1 Timothy or 2 Timothy?
2 Timothy 4:3, sorry.
4:3, for the time will come when they will not be able to endure sound doctrine. That's exactly what's going on now. People cannot hear the truth. But wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance to their own desires. They're greedy. They want money, health, wealth, all of that. So they will find these teachers and they will listen to them. Not because they want sound doctrine, but because they're of the flesh. These are not believers, and will turn away their ears from the truth. These same people, if they got a hold of a John McCurman, they'd be mad. They would reject everything he had to say and will turn aside to myths. What kind of myths? Oh, lots of myths, like, you know, Jesus is your genie. Just rub the lamp and ask him what, you know, and he'll... Oh, or the myth, here's my Bible, here's my spiritual language. Or the myth of, oh, come on down and I'll heal your headache. You know, they turn to this stuff because their heart is not desiring the gospel. They're going after these teachers because these teachers are saying what they want to hear. You know, a lot of times when you listen to people like, you know, John MacArthur or R.C. Sproul or... you know, any of these good, solid teachers, a lot of times what they have to say is hard stuff. It brings conviction to your heart, but you long for that. You know you need that. You want that. It's because you have the Holy Spirit in you.
Tony, it's hard time to hit right now. I'm wearing the hat. We're about 9:35 right now.
No, that's okay, because I need to spend some time with my wife. I haven't seen her.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you,
Tony. Can you pray us out, please?
I will.
Yes,
Tony.
Thank you.
Hopefully next time we'll be able to see face to face. Now let me pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for your word and the clarity, the perspicuity of your scripture. Lord, and we thank you for your Holy Spirit that leads us into all truth, that warns us from evil, us from false teaching, Lord. And just the ability to accept the truth, Lord, even when it's hard to hear sometimes. Father, I would pray that we would live in your spirit and walk in your spirit, Lord. Thank you for this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Tony. Amen. Really good, lively discussion tonight.
Good. No, very good. Good stuff, guys. Okay, I'm going to go.
All right. Thank you.
I will see you all later. Bye. I love you all.
Thank you. God bless.
Seriously, bless you. My beloved.
God bless.
Good night, Tony. Bye.